In this video, we investigate the behavior of monochromatic light when it strikes two thin slits. As we've already seen, Huygen's principle is useful for thinking about what happens to light when it passes through a slit, and I'll post a link back to that video real quick. In the Huygen's principle video, we learn that when light passes through a thin slit, it can be thought of as a point source for circular waves. In the animation we're viewing right now, we see what happens when wave fronts of light strike two thin slits. Each slit becomes a point source for circular waves, and those waves propagate outward from the slits in a very interesting way. Along some lines of sight, we have crests overlapping crests, troughs overlapping troughs, and these are the directions of constructive interference between the two sources. In between these, we have troughs overlapping crests, and these are the directions of destructive interference. We see an interference pattern emerging. Along the red lines, here, here along the center, and down here, we have crests and troughs that are landing on top of each other. Those waves reinforce each other and interfere constructively. Along the green lines, here, 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 and finally down here, we have crests that are lined up right on top of the trough from the other wave, and vice versa. That means the waves are going to interfere destructively. So when we project the pattern onto a screen, we obtain an intensity pattern given by this red curve. I have a maximum at the very center because that's a direction where the alignment is perfect and the waves reinforce each other. I have a dead spot at this point right here because that's along a line of sight where crests land on top of troughs and vice versa and the interference is destructive. And again, I get a bright spot along this line of sight where crests are lined up with crests and troughs lined up with troughs and I have constructive interference and so on. So when you run laser light through two slits, you end up seeing a series of dots if you project it on the wall. So I superimposed a photograph I took this morning using red laser light, and unfortunately it was so bright that my phone washed it out to make it look white. But this is what it looks like in real life. You have kind of a blob in the center, kind of a dead spot where you're getting destructive interference, and then another blob, and then another dead spot. The pattern is symmetric, so the same thing is happening on the other side of the center. I would normally call the one in the middle the central maximum, and then the ones that are the first bright spots off the center, I would call the first interference maximum. The two dark spots closest to the central maximum, I'd call those the first interference minimum. And then the second dark spot relative to the center line would be the second interference minimum, and so on. So to understand what's going on quantitatively, I've drawn a couple pictures here. And in the top picture, we're zoomed way out. I can see that my two slits are very, very close together in this picture. And the light from these two slits is aiming towards the first interference maximum that's off the center. So I know that that light is interfering constructively. So the light from the bottom slit clearly has a longer distance to travel here. And the reason the interference is constructive must be that it has exactly one extra wavelength of distance to travel, so that the waves arrive in phase at the screen and interfere constructively. So the path length difference for this first constructive interference must be equal to lambda, whatever the wavelength of the light is. I notice in the first picture that I have a Y labeled for the distance between the central max and the first interference max. I have the angle theta relative to the center line for the experiment, and I'm told the distance between the slits and the screen is capital D. But to really get into the math here, we've got to zoom in on those slits, and that's what we're doing in the second picture. I have a slit separation of little d, and it's critical that we're able to assume these two rays coming from the two slits have the same angle, and this will be very close to true, provided those slits are really close together compared to how far away the screen is. Just to give you a sense for it, in the lab we're normally dealing with a fraction of a millimeter between the slits and at least a couple meters for the distance between the slits and the screen. So the assumption that these rays come out at the same angle is a very good approximation. So again, the key physical concept here is that the bottom ray has a little bit farther to travel than the top ray to get to this first interference maximum. And if that path length difference is equal to one wavelength, the interference will be constructive. So the math all comes down to figuring out how to express that path length difference in terms of the parameters of the experiment. I noticed that that path length difference is a leg in a right triangle. I'm just going to label the right angle on the other side here so it doesn't interfere with our drawing. So that means the angle right here is also a right angle. And the hypotenuse of that triangle is little d, the slit separation. But I need to find the angle in this triangle. Well, all it takes is a little bit of trig here. I have theta added to this angle right here, giving me 90 degrees. Because I drew a perpendicular to that ray in order to find the path length difference. And that means this angle is 90 minus theta. But then that 90 minus theta plus the angle that we're interested in, this very tiny angle in the triangle, that adds up to 90 degrees. So the angle we're interested in plus 90 minus theta is equal to 90. Just hashing out the math real quick, the angle we're interested in plus 90 minus theta is equal to 90. Subtract 90 from both sides, add theta to both sides, and it turns out the angle we're interested in is also theta. And again, the path length difference is given by the opposite side of that right triangle, so the side opposite theta. And d is the hypotenuse, so my path length difference is going to be d sine theta. And I know that I get a constructive interference if that path length difference is equal to one wavelength, so that the waves arrive in phase at the screen. So that's my first constructive interference that's off the center. I also get a constructive right at the center because there is no path length difference for the rays traveling from the two slits if you're right on the center line. All right, of course we want to generalize. So I want to figure out, how do I express the conditions for my second constructive interference? Well, that happens if the path length difference is equal to twice the wavelength. So the waves would still arrive in phase and interfere constructively at the screen. And surely this continues for a path length difference of three wavelengths or four or five. So I can write down my general formula for the angles that give me constructive interference. So I get d sine theta equals n lambda, where n is an integer, and I'm going to include zero for the central maximum. And I'm not going to bother to put a plus or minus on each of these numbers, but I know that these interference maxima happen symmetrically in both directions. Now there's a useful modification to make to this formula that's especially convenient when you're in the lab. What you would normally measure is actually y. That's the distance between the central interference maximum and the first one off of that. It's the same as the distance between any two adjacent maxima. That's something you can measure with a ruler in the lab. So I want to re-express my formula in terms of y. And we're going to use an approximation for this. And the approximation is that sine theta is approximately equal to the tangent of theta, provided theta is very small. And we definitely qualify in this case because we're ordinarily talking about fractions of degrees for these angles. Well, if you buy that, then I could replace sine theta with, I can see in the diagram, tangent theta is y over d. And this allows me to directly talk about the distance between the center line and the location of these different interference maxima. So I can rework my formula like this. And now I've got something that's probably more useful in the lab. The last thing I want to do on this slide is figure out, well, what are the angles that get me to these dark spots where I have destructive interference? That happens if the waves arrive out of phase. I've already got a general expression for the path length difference from the two slits based on the angle. And so what happens at the first destructive interference is that the waves arrive out of phase because the path length difference is equal to one half of a wavelength. So I write down path length difference. Again, I can express that as d sine theta equals whatever the wavelength of the light is over 2. So this means when a crest from one wave is arriving at that point on the screen, a trough from the other wave is arriving and they interfere destructively. So anything that gets them out of phase by half a wavelength causes destructive interference. It doesn't have to be just one half of a wavelength. It could be a half of a wavelength plus a whole wavelength. In other words, 1.5 wavelengths out of phase. And that would be our second destructive. So that happens again at 3 lambda over 2, or 1.5 wavelengths out of phase. So to generalize this, I have my path length difference d sine theta is equal to n plus a half times lambda, where n is equal to 0, 1, 2, and so on. So just plugging in n equals 0 there, I would get a path length difference of a half wavelength. That's my first destructive interference. Plug in n equals 1, and I get a path length difference of 3 lambda over 2. That's my second destructive interference, and so on. Finally, we can rework this in terms of the actual distances we measure on the screen, those y values, by using sine theta is approximately tangent theta, which is y over d. So that's pretty much it for the analysis of two-slit interference. Let's wrap things up with a quick example. So in this one, we're given the wavelength of the light, 633 nanometer red laser light, passing through a pair of slits separated by 0.15 millimeters. And the interference pattern is projected on a wall that's 5 meters distant. I want to compute the angle and the approximate distance, in other words, the Y value, between the central maximum and the first and second maxima. And then I want to get the angle and approximate distance between the central maximum and the first and second minima. So really, we're just plugging into our formulas to practice a little bit. So first, we'll do the constructive interferences. So I have a formula giving those locations as an angle, and then a formula giving those locations as a distance from the center line. We'll do our first maximum, and I plug in that slit separation of 0.15 millimeters. I've got to put that in the right units. And that first maximum occurs when the two waves are out of phase by exactly one wavelength. In other words, it's the n equals 1 maximum. And lambda is 633 nanometers, so 633 times 10 to the negative 9. So we just divide both sides by 0.00015 and invert the sine function. Make sure you're set in degrees here, and I get 0.242 degrees, just keeping 3 sig figs on this. Alternatively, I can solve for the Y value corresponding to that angle. Now, either you can take that angle and just go do the trig from scratch, or I can use my second formula here. If I solve that second formula for Y, that's n lambda big D, the distance to the screen, over little d, the slit separation. And we're talking again about n equals 1 in this case, the first maximum. And this gives me 0.0211 meters. It'd be nicer to write that as 2.11 centimeters. So you'll see that first off-center bright spot about 2 centimeters away from the center bright spot. Then we do all the same things for the second interference maximum. The only thing that changes is that we plug in n equals 2, which means our path length difference is equal to 2 wavelengths of the light. And I get an angle of 0.484 degrees. You'll notice that's just twice the angle for the first one, and this is true because our angular changes are so small that we're in a regime where the sine function is practically linear. And then just streamlining the calculation again, to get the Y value for the second maximum, I just replace the n with a 2 in the formula. So I have a 2 times 633 times 10 to the negative 9 times 5, all divided by that slit separation, 0.00015. And again, I end up with twice the value I got before, and that's 4.22 centimeters in this case to the second bright fringe off center. Next, we handle our destructive interferences, in other words, the dark spots that separate the interference maxima. And I have my formula in terms of angle, d sine theta equals n plus a half times lambda, where n is equal to 0 for the first one, 1 for the second one, and so on. Or again, replacing sine theta with approximately y over d. So to get the angle for my first destructive interference, I just plug in n equals 0. And to 3 sig figs, I get 0.121 degrees, which you'll notice is half our original angle for the first maximum. In other words, this minimum just occurs halfway between the central max and the first off-center max. All right, then I apply the second formula because I'm interested in finding y for this dark spot. I'll go ahead and solve for y in general. That's just big D times n plus a half times lambda, all divided by little d. And again, we're plugging in n equals 0 for the first interference minimum. And I get 0.0106 meters. But it's nicer to look at it in centimeters. That's 1.06 centimeters off center. Again, if I compare to where my first maximum was, that's about halfway between the center line and the first maximum. I get that dark spot. That's 1.06 centimeters. All right, then we get our second one, and I'm running out of space, so I have to streamline a little bit here. All we do is plug in n equals 1, and that gives me a 3 halves in this part of the formula. So I get 0.363 degrees for the angular location of this second dark spot. Then when I try to find the actual distance between the center line and the second dark spot, I use this formula where I've solved for y, and I'm going to plug in n equals 1, giving me a 3 halves in those parentheses. So I have d, that's 5 times 3 halves times the wavelength, all divided by the slit separation in the appropriate units. In writing it in centimeters, I get 3.17 centimeters off center for that second dark line. If you find the physics content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce over 100 new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.